chug-a-lug, chug-a-lug. Make you wanna holler, hidey-ho. Burns your tummy, don't you know? Chug-a-lug, chug-a-lug.
This is SF Barcast. I am Jeff Cleary.
And I am Kurt Schilling impersonator Andrew Lauder.
And Andrew, where are we today?
We are at the Parkside.
The Parkside. This neighborhood is sort of like Lower Potrero Hill.
Yeah, like 17th and Wisconsin, I think, is the exact cross streets.
It's Potrero Hill, but it's not on the hill. It's
no.
At the base of the hill.
Well, and the Parkside comes from the fact that it's like directly across the street from Jackson Playground or
which
Jackson
is a great
park. Yeah.
It's a great neighborhood park. They have, like, softball games there. And there's, like, a school around here, too. It's, like, a real neighborhood.
Yeah, what the hell?
I know. It's, like, we don't
usually... We shouldn't be allowed here.
We were over there, like, throwing the wiffle ball around. And there were all these, like, little kids running around. I was like, where do these midgets come from? And I was like, oh, no, those are kids. In San Francisco, there's not a whole lot of children.
No. And they reminded us of this, like, when we were there. They said, you folks aren't allowed within 100 yards of children.
No, 100 feet's 100 feet.
Well, the Parkside has an extra E, and as people from New York will know, the extra E stands for extra P.
Why do people in New York say that?
That was part of a public access, like it was the same thing that, like, was it Robin Fox or who's that awful?
Oh, was it Channel J?
Yeah, it was like basically, like, you didn't have to sign up, like, or pay money or, like, be of age to see, like, porn in New York.
Yeah, it was like the late 80s and the early 90s.
Like, hey, you got cable television? Like, you better be ready for some tits and ass.
Yeah, exactly. I think it was called Channel J.
Yeah.
And they had a naked talk show. Mm. And you had to see it to believe it, because right. It was like, yeah, they're out there, totally naked, yeah. And asking serious questions, like...
And yeah. not the people you want to see naked either, at
right,
all.
Exactly. And like... And the questions are just like, well, you know, what do you think of certain current events? Not like, why is that hanging out?
Right. Well, and it's like very early videotape, like, sort of like television as well. So it's all
on VTR.
Like that, yeah. And like, so, you know, like you can barely hear it. You can sort of make out the awfulness that's going on. But like a part of that Channel J or whatever like that was a television advertisement that would run constantly, because I'm sure they had one or two advertisers. And like it was basically like a 900 number, or like, you know, or the you know, whatever the first pay numbers were. And it was like 1-900-PEEE. And it was like, and the extra, and it was basically a phone number to call if you like to get peed on.
Wow.
And and they said that their slogan was, the extra E is for extra P.
You know, I mean, I wouldn't judge anything as far as sexuality speaking, of course.
Right.
But it does kind of like myth me that like that's like something people like. You know, like, I mean, and you know, there's no explanation for it. Whatever turns you on.
Right, right.
But yeah, I'm just like, you know what? Maybe for me, maybe I'm just a little too traditional. It's like, we don't need any water sports going on.
Yeah, there's a certain, there's a point in time where, like, it definitely crosses the line between, like, you know, hey, you know, to each his own, and then you sort of cross over into, like, nah, you should keep that to yourself.
Well, you know, thanks to the internet, you get to see, like, all the things that you did, like, even if you think you have a really good imagination, there's stuff out there that turns people on the internet that you never would have come up with, and that's when you, like, really appreciate, like, oh, wow, thank God that it's... Thank God it's the stuff that turns me on. It's not right. That. It's not like right. Stepping on chicks or something like that.
Right. Well, and back then, I mean, like, you know, you would have to go to much greater lengths to, I'm sure that, you know, I mean, the internet today, like, you know, like if, you know, you throw in the search term, like, you know, girl or guy gets peed on, you know, you're going to have pages and pages and pages to look at.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, back in that time, I'm sure, like, you know, like, if that was your particular, like, you know, fetish or like that, it's really hard to, like, track down. Like,
right. Actually, somebody told me that because, like, porn is so readily available on the internet everywhere, that right. The only, like, porn sites that are really doing well are, like, fetish sites, like kink.com.
So just standard porn sites are going out of business. They're like, yeah, there's no hook to it.
Right. Yeah, exactly. So guy on girl action. Kind of seen that before.
You are boring the tits off of everyone on the internet.
Exactly.
with your simple insertion.
Yeah. Maybe you could do some mime sex or something. You know, that might work. That might work.
Well, we should definitely save that for when we have Eric Cash on the show. But anyway.
Right. Well,
So what do you think of this
place? You
know,
we should probably stop talking about fetish stuff and start talking about the bar.
Now that we've alienated most of the audience, like, it's like we can continue on.
Now that everybody's gone, Andrew.
It's like, now it's just you and me.
So we're at the Parkside.
Yes, yes.
And this bar is really, it's got a great, like, outdoor, I guess you'd call it a beer garden out back. But unlike other, like, beer gardens in the city, that if it's raining here, you can still come here because they have this see-through plastic awning.
Right, right, right. I was immediately reminded, actually, when I walked in here. It's been a little while since I've been here. And I mean, I knew about, you know, the back and everything like that, and I remember it. But, like, I really do like it a lot. Like, I think, like walking back into it, I realized, oh, you know what? Like, this is one of the best outdoor, like, you know, beer gardens in the city, for sure.
There have been many times where you and I are sitting around, and it's, like, a nice day, and we're just like, yeah, well, we don't want to go to Zeitgeist because it's going to be mobbed.
Exactly,
and
yeah,
and so then we're in our minds, we're, like, going over where all the beer gardens are. There's one at, like, it's not even called Rat and Raven anymore in the...
Oh, in Noe Valley.
Noe Valley,
like,
yeah. That's a good one. But, like, we always forget about this one. Maybe because, like...
It's a little out of the way. I mean, like, yeah, it, you know...
It's not that far, but, like, you know, I know, like, I lived in San Francisco a long time before I would go to Potrero Hill, other than Bottom of the Hill, which is, like, one of the best rock venues in the city.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, they also have a bunch of bands here, too.
Oh, so, yeah, totally. Yeah, this place is, like, quite, you know, getting quite known for... And it has been, I should say, like, quite known for a while. It's, you know, being sort of like a... you know, a little bit more hardcore punk, like, you know, like, but then they also, I guess, like, on Sundays, they have, like, twang Sundays, which are, like, sort of country, like, so it's sort of like that same sort of, like, zeitgeist sort of, you know, rockabilly atmosphere, but, like, you know, like, a little more, like, you know, sort of
it's
punk
kind
swing.
Of like a, like, yeah, it's got kind of a skateboardy sort of, like, feel with all the skate stickers and stuff, but... Yeah, it's a very, like, kind of punkabilly sort of feel to it.
Yeah, totally, yeah.
But it's a great bar. Like,
oh, yeah.
I've seen a few, like, fantastic bands here. Actually, I was here once, and I remember I was, like, looking at this one dude in the corner, and I was like, I know that guy. Like, you know when you can't figure out, like, where you knew someone? And I was, like, convinced that it was, like, someone I had met in the past.
Right, right.
And suddenly it dawned on me. It's like, oh, that's Peter Buck from REM.
Holy shit.
I was just like, and I was going to go over to him and be like... Didn't we meet at, like, the some mission bar? And you were like, no.
Be like, are you the guy that got brain damage, or is that the drummer?
I should have rolled up to him and said, like, hey, you know what? You may not remember me, but I have all of your albums. So there you go.
Right. I even bought that shitty side project you did with.
What was that?
I forget. I remember he did some sort of, like, thing with, like, it must have been, like, one of the guys from, like. Like, if it was today, he would have done it with, like, Wilco or, like, yeah, you know, or, like, you know, Jeff Tweedy or something, but, like...
You know, one of the other things as far as, like, music I want to point out here is we have a friend of the show, Parker Gibbs, who has a, like, he produces a music show here every year, and so I think it's on his birthday, or I don't even know if he does it every year, but, like, I know that this used to be the home of Parker Palooza.
Oh.
And Parker would handpick bands that he likes, and Parker has amazing taste in music. In fact, he's a DJ. He goes under the DJ name DJ Food Court.
All right.
And, like, any obscure stuff, like, he has it and he knows it. He's just got an encyclopedic knowledge of music.
Nice.
Good guy.
Good guy. We vouch for him. Still, he's trying to get into your club. Say, like, oh, yeah, I heard about him on the Barcast.
Still is a good man.
He's one of the good ones.
Oh, you know what? I should have said this at the top of the show, but I really want to apologize for the last episode.
The St. Patrick's Day episode?
The St. Patrick's Day episode towards the end, like, where I could not...
Aaron,
like,
go, what?
At the beginning, it's like, oh, great. And, like, you know, I'm like, oh, we're doing like, six bars in one day, and at St. Patrick's
Day,
it's
great.
What could go wrong? At the last one, I think we were at Finnegan's Wake, I was, like, trying to... You know, compose sentences and just failing miserably. And I was just like, all right, we gotta go. This is a podcast. See you later.
Hey, but you know what? We were discussing this before. And, like, that's the beauty of podcasting is we can't get fired for shit like that. And, like, we can, of course, like, you know, have some self respect and, like, try not to do things like that.
Well,
but,
you know, the self respect.
No, that's never gonna happen.
Self respect is optional.
Exactly. That's just stupid. Like, we wouldn't be doing this if it was something that you had to have self respect to be good at.
That'd be funny if, like, the FCC. Had to, like, regulate podcasts as well. Like, be like, we're okay with all the vulgarity and all the horrible things you guys say, but have some self-respect.
Right. Just like, hey, you've violated the mush mouth drunken idiot rule.
So you can, that plays on Channel J, but like not everywhere else, you're going to have a problem.
We have vigorous standards here at Stitcher and iTunes, and we are not going to like just let anything pass by our interface.
Hey, do you want to talk about the kitchen here?
Yeah, we should. Like, actually, I noticed as I walked into this place. Now I'm like a reality television watcher / junkie, whatever. Like,
extraordinaire.
I watch all that kind of bullshit. And the very second that I walked in here, I looked over the bartender's shoulder and into the kitchen, and I saw Josie from Top Chef, who is, and she was just on the most recent Top Chef Seattle as one of like the, and she, you know, she's been on a couple of seasons of it actually, and she's sort of like a, I don't know if you wouldn't call her necessarily like a spicy Latina, but like, I mean, she's, you know, she's very into like, you know, bold flavors and like, you know, and sort of, you know, mixing it up and stuff like that. And so she apparently like is sort of like their resident chef here, and like she, you know, runs this little like sort of like, you know, food outfit in the back here.
Is so, this like, the second time we've had come in contact with the Top Chef chefs?
Possibly at
High Tops.
Oh, they yeah, you're right, that, you're right.
Is it the same woman?
No, that's a different person. I mean, like, at High Tops, San Francisco is obviously like a huge sort of like, you know, feeding ground for, okay, you know, for that kind of bullshit.
At High Tops, they said that their menu was designed or
written
up by one of the Top Chef chefs.
Yeah, and like there's, you know, I could list like five or six like Top Chef chefs that have like either like started here, like one at Absinthe, and like, you know, and like they're all over the place. Like, yeah, so it's a big, it's a big sort of a training ground or whatever like that for you know, next level chefs that are coming.
That's the thing, like, you know, if people don't know, like, people who listen to us in San Francisco already know that like the food culture here is just out of control. Like,
oh, totally. It,
yeah, like, yeah, chefs are like rock stars.
Yeah, here. Definitely.
Like,
yeah,
like, there are some people who know exactly who every chef is.
Yeah. No, it's crazy. Yeah. Like, and it like the internet and Twitter and everything like that has only made it worse. It's just, yeah, like. Like the
worse
second,
or better.
Well, yeah, the second that, like, you know, a chef of note or, like, a name, you know, wants to open a food stand or like that, there's, like, a you know, line around the block of Japanese and Chinese Twitter users that are ready to eat it. So, but, yeah, that's, but, yeah, so that's, I mean, that's another, I mean, like, that, yeah, the park side that I remember certainly wouldn't have had, like, a high-caliber chef cooking in the back. But like, I mean, that's sort of the evolution that even like sort of your quote unquote dive bars are now like like have to have like a kick-ass food program to keep everybody around.
Yeah,
like,
it's definitely an improvement where it's like, yeah, this place can still be as punk rock as it wants to be, but they have a top-notch chef.
Right. It's like, hey, act like you don't care, everybody, but like secretly you really have to care a lot. Remember, there's no rules here at the park side, but there are lots of rules.
It's like, you can't get drunk and, like, sick when you're eating, like, and we can't serve you, like, horrible food.
Right, exactly. You're going to pound PBRs all night. We at least owe you, like, a, you know, fried oyster sandwich or something.
Didn't our friend Sean say that in Portland, Oregon, every bar has to serve food?
Really?
Which sounds great because you're like, oh, yeah, like, you know, if you're leaving and you're like, oh, I'm a little too drunk, like, maybe I should, like, you know, put some food in my stomach and settle myself out. It sounds great, but someone told me it's actually not great because the food they serve is just like kind of microwave pizza. If you're at a bar that's good and they're like, oh yeah, we're gonna, you know, serve some good food, then you're golden.
Right.
But if you're at a bar where it's like, oh, there's these fucking laws, so they'll like microwave a pizza for you, and then you'll feel worse as you're leaving.
But you probably, I mean, like, I'm sure that you can probably tell, like, walking into the bar, you're like, oh, I probably don't want to order their, you know, Totino's special. Like that, you know, like,
I wonder if that's true about the strip clubs in Portland as well.
It might be, actually, because I remember
they
like
they serve alcohol there.
Yeah, like I remember going in back when I lived in Portland, like actually a couple times at the job that I was at, would like people would go to like strip clubs for lunch. And like, and it was as sad as you would think, because it's just like these like day shift strippers, and like, yeah, they're serving you chicken wings, and like, and so you're just sitting there like with this like awful Caesar salad or something like that in front of them, and be like, yeah, it's a very nice vagina you got there, thank you.
Well, whenever you go to Portland, everywhere, someone like points out like, oh, well, you know, we have the most strip clubs per capita of any place.
Big
in the
point
world.
Of pride.
Big point of pride. You know, it's not the beautiful landscape. Right. Or
we have more damaged women than anywhere in the world.
But it does kind of seem weird where it's like, if you're at a strip club and you're just like, you know, I'm a little hungry now. Yeah. Go over here and grab a...
Look at her tits all afternoon.
You know, really... a cannoli? I mean, I can, like, play a little hide the cannoli. Ooh.
Ouch.
But although, you know what, that's not, like, rare. Like, a friend of mine, when I was working at Gap, she loved to go to the Gold Club, which is, like, one of the big, like, strip clubs in San Francisco.
Right.
And, but it's right next to the convention center. Right. So, like, it's probably the most heavily trafficked
strip
clubs.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
There are strip clubs in North Beach.
It's like, hey, you on an expense account? Like, come throw hundreds at us.
I wonder, like, they should just have, like, a big, like, neon sign in front of the Gold Club that just says, like, what the charges on your credit card will come up as. It's like blanking. It's like, yeah, oh, yeah. And then you can put it all, like,
right, it's like
write it all off.
Like, they just, like, register themselves as, like, a Kiva charity or something like that, where it's just, like you'll be helping a farm out in Ecuador.
Right. Yeah, like, but my friend Mari, she loved to go to the Gold Club for Friday brunch. Okay. And the brunch there was really good. And I went with her once, and it was actually, like, fantastic food. But the thing is, like, you know, she's, like, loving it. Because right. She's, like, you know, she's... Every time I go to a strip club, like... Strippers can smell fear, so they pick up on me, and like, right. Even I could have a full plate of food in front of me, and then some stripper will sit in my lap and be like, right. Oh honey, you want like a private dance, and like, of course, my friend, I'm like on my lunch
break,
trying
to eat my nachos.
I gotta go back this afternoon and sell khakis.
Oh, well, hey, should we take a break?
Yeah, let's take a break. Let's get another beer.
Okay.
All right, this is SF Barcast, and we are at the Parkside.
The extra E is for extra Parkside.
Or as they say in Boston, the Parkside.
The Parkside.
Back. This is SF Barcast.
Hello.
And we are at the Parkside in Potrero Hill.
Exactly.
This is our first Potrero Hill bar.
It is. Like it's a great area. Like, I mean, like, it's a very underrated part of San Francisco. I think that most people from out of town are never going to see Potrero Hill.
That's true. I know a lot of people who moved over here because the rents were cheaper, or the houses they bought, like houses over here, because it's cheaper. I don't know if that's still the case, because I feel like everywhere in San Francisco is pretty expensive. Yeah. But in this neighborhood, you also have the Ankerstein Brewery.
This is true.
I remember I was playing a softball game over at Jackson Park, and suddenly there was just like this overwhelming like scent of hops. And I thought, I mean, like, some people were like on the team were just like, oh, that's smelly. Ooh. I'm just like, that's fucking beautiful.
you just assumed that you had passed out and were
let
like,
it just waft over you. Don't worry, you'll like it eventually.
You're like passed out in the outfield, like going like, can everybody else smell it?
Yeah, I threw my mitt down and just like started running towards the smell.
Exactly, but and it's also like. If you're a baseball fan, it'd be a good place to live. It's pretty close to like AT&T Park. Like,
oh yeah,
like,
yeah.
You know, like you can sort of like, you know, make that part of your life if you want.
Like the strange thing about this neighborhood is like way, way back in the day, and in a different life, I worked for Super Shuttle.
Uh-huh.
And Super Shuttle, they had their office and their garage of right. where all their vans were right down here, and it's all gone. Like, when I first started working over there, like, this whole area, like, just north of Potrero Hill was just a wasteland.
And you need, like, a Kleenex or anything like that? Like, to
exactly.
Dab the tears away from your eyes.
No, you know
the
why?
The glory days of a Super Shell parking lot.
Because I wasn't going to, like, stand in front of a bulldozer and, and, like, you know, try to stop them from developing this neighborhood. Right. Because, you know what, it could use a little developing. But like, now, it is...
But what parking lots are we going to do coke in now?
Exactly. Don't worry, you'll find one. Tried the mission. But this neighborhood down here, like, UCSF has moved in, and it's just a massive, like, I guess it's research, medical research.
Eggheads.
Like, yeah, well, I think they do a lot of, like, stem cell research down here as well.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, so take that, I don't know, like, ultra-conservative America.
Do they even care about that anymore? Like, it seems like the bulldozer of time is really, like, tearing apart, like, conservative ideals.
I just went on a road trip, and, like, one of the things I'd love to do on a road trip is scan for Christian radio stations. And you'd be really surprised. Like, there's a lot of people who are still, like, you know, very much against stem cell research.
Well, even, like...
What I would say to them is that they wouldn't be against stem cell research if they knew two things. That, you know, all the amazing, like, advances that come out of stem cell research.
Right.
And also how delicious stem cells are. Woo-wee!
Especially baby stem cells.
Ooh, yeah.
It's, like, tender.
It's like, eat it all up.
Well, it's funny, my wife is Facebook friends with a great number of huge, like, religious conservatives from, like, you know, people that she knew from high school and has since lost contact with, but, like, remained Facebook friends with for some reason, and they're, like, and they'll just, like, come up with these, like, gems of, like, you know, Facebook posts that are just, like, you know, mwah, delicious. And one of them recently was, like, for the whole marriage equality thing, like, is sort of going on right now.
Uh-huh.
It's, like, being debated in the Supreme Court. And this person, like, you know, you could tell that, like, the religious conservative movement really wanted to, like, sort of stand up and say a lot of crazy fucking shit. But, like, it was such a huge sort of, like, wave, like, of support for this that they were afraid to. And, like, finally this one person found, like, sort of a way to do it where, like, she was like, look, you know, like, I understand people, blah, 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 you know, like, have to, like, you know, express themselves or like that. But, like, I think it's really poor taste that they chose, like, Easter weekend, like, to debate all this stuff. Because
they're like, we should be thinking
about Jesus Christ. But instead, like, Satan has us thinking about all this other stuff. Like,
we should be thinking about this one guy who hung out with, like, 12 guys. Instead, we're talking about gay marriage.
Right. What the hell? But it's, like, it's such a, like, desperate sort of, like, yeah, like well, you didn't say Jesus, so, like,
well,
you know, Simon says.
Hey, what's up, Powder? We should, like, point out that, well, I have something else to say about that, but, like, Powder, the bar cat. Just came over and wanted to say hi.
He's quite adorable.
He is quite adorable. He is a fully white cat named Powder.
He's like a super albino cat. Like, he's just solid white, pink eyes, like.
White Powder.
Exactly.
Yep.
Amazing that he can stay out in
actually,
the sun.
Actually, I love, you know, we should, at this point, we should do, like, dog or no dog. And
yeah.
I'm going to say dog because Powder is here and Powder's there.
Right.
But the thing is, like, you know, like, of course, like, dogs would chase the cat. But the bartender was telling us that the cat, like, lives upstairs and he does whatever he wants. If he doesn't want to be here, he can just go upstairs.
Cats will basically tell dogs to fuck off if they have a certain area that, like, I think most dogs are afraid of cats. Like, you know,
most dogs are afraid of cats.
I think so. Secretly, like,
we only hate the ones we love.
Exactly. Like, I'm saying, like, you know, if you get them drunk, they'll tell you that they're secretly afraid of cats.
So, yeah, I'm thinking, like, dogs are fine at the parkside.
It's certainly, I mean, like, and it's great. I mean, like, I think you said that this is the first bar you've been to with, like, a designated, like, bar cat.
Yeah,
like,
you don't see too many of those. Do you know, like, there was a tradition on naval vessels to have a cat?
Really?
Yeah, I looked it up and it's
to
like...
To eat, or...?
No, the cat would be the mascot of, like, the submarine or, like, the destroyer.
Wow.
And it would, like, run around. I guess it goes way back to... like old, like, maritime days where, like, when you pulled into a port, you, like, I guess rats would try to get onto the ships.
Oh, okay.
So you tie up your ship on the dock, right, and the rats would go on the ropes and try to get into the ship, and like the cat would just go and like take care of those rats.
Yeah. Well, excellent. Good for those cats.
So there you go.
So if you have a cat and you really want to make it happy, get like a old timey like pirate ship, and like it can like patrol it. It'll be the happiest cat in the world.
So I had one more thing I wanted to say about marriage equality, because that's happening right now, and it looks like it's going to, it's going like the Defense of Marriage Act is going to get like shot down. It's a big thing for California because the whole thing like revolves around California.
Right.
First off, I want to like talk. I want to say like how cowardly the Supreme Court is. It's like people are like saying that they're trying to find a way out of like out of deciding this for the whole country. They're like, oh, this is California's problem. Why does the Supreme Court? It's like, just man up and you know, make a decision. But so I think like we should like just say for a lot of our listeners where we stand on this subject, and I'm going to speak for SFRcast, and not only do I want marriage equality to go through, I want gays to be able to marry, but I want the Supreme Court to decide that gays legally can marry in America, but I also want them to decide that they can also fuck in public.
Okay.
Only because there's...
Is it an all or nothing proposition, or are you willing to bend at least on like some of that?
Well, there's also like this, you know, when going into like this argument, you think like, oh, this is gonna like really like bother a lot of people. Then you realize that like something like 58% of America is like in favor of gay marriage, and you're just like, oh shit, like how, like we need to like maximize our return on like or annoying people, right?
Right, exactly.
So like we can't just like if 60% of people like want gay marriage, we gotta like do something even further than that.
Exactly, yeah. Like We should like definitely like you know, reinforce like the whole belief of like the slippery slope argument, where it's like, you know, like at the very last minute they should like, you know, jump in and be like, oh, and we can marry dogs too, right?
And turtles.
Box turtles as well. Fantastic.
All right, you want to take a break?
We can take a break if you like.
And we will be right back. This is SF Barcast from the PAC side.
The EE PAC side.
And we're back at the Parkside.
The Parkside.
In Potrero Hill.
17th in Wisconsin.
Hey, one of the other things I want to like point out about this bar is that they have a photo booth here.
Ooh.
And some people like that. Like, okay. I've been sort of learning. I mean, like, I've been going to bars for a long time.
Right.
And then, like, learning what people like. And like I said, a lot of my friends have been kind of coming out of the closet as they're huge pinball fans.
Right.
And I had no idea about that, but like I know there's probably a lot of people who are into like photo booths. Like people like to do stupid shit.
Oh, totally.
So you get drunk and you go in a photo booth.
Exactly.
You know, it's
I
fun.
Was at a wedding recently that had a photo booth, and like that was a big deal there. Like
a photo booth wedding, right?
And like not only the photo booth, but then they had the accoutrements, the wacky sunglasses, the crazy hats you can put on. Like,
were there
you
know, two clowns getting married?
I think so. Yeah.
The other thing we should point out with it, while they do have like a great like backyard and like beer garden here, mm-hmm. there's no pool table and there's no dart board, there's no pinball.
Oh.
But I think if you come here, you come to like see the music and get something to eat,
exactly,
and hang out in the beer garden. That's enough.
Give it a rest with the fucking pinball.
Exactly. Don't be so goddamn neurotic that you have to be doing something all the time.
Just get over it. Like, just, you know, spend one night having a drink without having to, like, you know, fucking go crazy on the, you know.
Well, what did you say the cross street is here?
It's Wisconsin.
Wisconsin.
Yeah, yeah.
A team that did not do very, very well in the college basketball tournament.
No, they did not. In fact, that seems like a perfect segue into discussing our most recent trip outside the Bay Area.
Yes, we went to Vegas last week. Right.
Las Vegas, for those of you who don't know.
Las Vegas, Nevada.
As opposed to the other Vegas.
And we went out there for the first, like, 4 days of the college basketball tournament.
True.
And I have to say, like, all I do is complain about Vegas, but, like the trip that we had last weekend is the flip side of, like, my hatred of Vegas. It was so much fun.
Yeah.
And I still don't think I could ever live there.
No, certainly not.
But, like, going in there and, like, you know, laying, like, money on games and just, like, having a fantastic time with friends. And then getting up and, like, leaving.
Yeah, that's the best part, I think. There's certainly, like, you build it up in your head before you get there, and then when you get there, it's one thing, and then, like, by the time that you have to leave, like, you're totally ready to leave. Like, it's there's only a certain amount. I mean, like, and I used to smoke all the time and everything like that,
smoke
cigarettes.
Right, yeah.
And not that I'm, like, hypersensitive to it or anything like that, but it's just, you know, like, after a while, like, if you're hanging out in casinos all day, like, you are getting, like, a barrage of, like, cigarette and, like, and mostly cigar smoke.
Secondary smoke.
But it
does feel weird because, like, you know, when somebody, like, lights up a cigarette in California, you're like, oh, my God, that guy doesn't care about anything. You know, he's just such a rebel.
Right.
But in Nevada, it's everywhere.
Right. Plus, I think it's such a sort of girl drinking, engineered like place that, like, you know, unless you want to, like, go to, like, someplace like Numb in Caesar's Palace or something like that, where it's like you're gonna get, like, some, like, ridiculously strong, like, fruity cocktail, basically a Slurpee with, like, you know, like a half a bottle of rum in it. Like, it's hard to find, like, a decent drink in Las Vegas. I mean, like, yeah, like there's not really any such thing as craft beers. It's all, like, you know, like, Bud Light.
Well, you can. There are some places you can find that stuff at, but, like...
Right. It's far and few between, though, it seems like.
A friend of mine is running the downtown project in Las Vegas.
Yeah.
And that is where they're trying to revitalize the old downtown, like, Fremont Street and around there. And basically, like, they're trying to make it cool, make it hip. And which I think is, like, totally noble of him trying to do, because it's, you know, it was kind of run down.
Right.
But, like, he took me to a bar called Commonwealth.
Right.
And it is a fantastic bar. I mean, it's clearly, you could feel that it was a interior decorator's dream.
Right.
Like, you know, he spent a lot of money on the inside. And it's like, and they had an amazing list of beers you could buy. But right. So I'm like, oh, they have Arrogant Bastard. I got, like, a 12-ounce glass of Arrogant Bastard, $9.
Of course. And that's probably considered, like, and they're probably like, what are you complaining about? Like, that's the cheapest beer in Vegas.
Well, they're probably thinking, you know what, like, that's a craft beer, even though it's, like, from San Diego, which is, like, four hours away.
All right.
They're just like, oh, well, you got to pay extra for, like, you know, some craft beer, some, like, really, you know,
my favorite,
out of the way beer.
Easily my favorite, like, beer price, like, the entire time we were there was this place called Pure in Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas, you know, which is granted.
Oh, I mean, right.
Like, it's a total, like, sort of, you know, douchebag place to be seen, like, yeah, you know, like, you know, like, hey, like, the girls are wearing, like, you know, referee's outfits and she's sitting on my lap. Ah. You know, like, it's totally, like, a terrible place like that. But one of their specials, and this is a special, mind you, was six cans of Coors Light in a bucket, you know, in a steel bucket, for $45.
$45. I know, because I remember we went there and I bought the first round, and we're with our friends Eric and Lisa, and neither of them drink, or, like, Lisa doesn't drink that much, Eric doesn't drink. So I was like, oh, yeah, you know, like, I bought a beer for you, bought a beer for me, and I got, you know, two Diet Cokes for the two of them.
Right.
And the Diet Cokes were $6. And I'm just like, that is God. I mean, I guess you pay if you if you're at Caesar's and you're at like whatever their shishi like little bar.
Right.
You got to like know that, that's. I mean, there's got to be places in Las Vegas where you can get like somebody told me, you can. There's some places where you can go get like dollar beers.
Right. I mean, that's the thing is like I feel like the entire slogan of most of Las Vegas should be like, yeah, like where do you think you are?
It's like, yeah.
It's like if anybody says like really you're charging me like yeah. $50 for a you know, Budweiser, they'd be like, yeah, where do you fucking think you are? Like, yeah.
Well, no, there's such a wide spectrum. It's such a wide spectrum where it's like, yeah, you have like Pure on one side where you're paying like $6 for a Diet Coke.
Right.
And then there are places that are probably like off the strip. Yes. They're just like, yeah, you can get dollar, like, you know.
Well, even like the place, because the place where we sort of like did most of our hanging out. Was like
Green Valley Ranch.
The Green Valley Ranch, like out in Henderson, Nevada, like which is close to where like you know, your friend Lisa lives, which is kind of great because you're sort of like out into sort of locals only territory at that point.
By the way, I will not stop podcasting until I can announce that Green Valley Ranch is one of SF Barcast's sponsors.
That would be great.
Although they probably don't want to have anything to do with me right now because I took them for so much money in the college basketball tournament. Bragging. Well, yeah.
I made up for it, so they'll let me in, but not you. I think that like even like a place like out of the way like that, like it was still a bit of a hassle to get a drink because it's like yeah, it's like you know one big giant bar, and like and unless you knew the special of the day, like which was usually like a frozen margarita for a dollar or something, you know, something totally suspect like that, and the margarita is like yeah. Like 99% mix, 1% like you know,
yeah. But they were also didn't they also have like $2 Jameson shots?
They did, like which was crazy. But like you know, it's like you know, you have to like. Well,
that's mine. The fried chicken's mine.
Excellent. Oh,
are you okay?
Yeah.
Thank you, Josie. All right, so our food just got here, so I think we should take a break.
That's a good idea. All right, let's don't annoy everybody by chewing while talking.
that's some like. That's some Andy Warhol podcasting. Where it's like 2 hours of me chewing. But this is SF Barcast, and we're at the Parkside.
All right, see you on the other side.
This is SF Barcast, and we are back at the Parkside. I'm Jeff Cleary.
I'm Andrew Lauder.
And Andrew, we just finished our food from the Parkside.
It's quite
How
amazing.
Was it? Was yours as amazing as mine?
It was really good. I have to admit.
You had the burger.
I did. I had the British Invasion burger, which is aged English cheddar, curry aioli, onion chutney, and pickled cucumber.
And I had the spicy Southern fried chicken sandwich, and it was absolutely amazing. And as a side, we had the their Mac Attack cheese, mac mm-hmm. and cheese with jalapenos, and my God, like
cheesy and spicy.
I'd like this place when I first got here.
Oh, yeah.
And then I realized that they have a bar cap, and they realized that they have great food, and now they're playing the Bee Gees 70s soft rock. Like, if I could fuck this bar, I would right now.
Here we go.
I'll be right back.
And it won't be you won't be filled with the shame you would if you would fuck the high top. Like,
oh, absolutely.
Oh, after that. Excuse me, just choking some food down.
So we both had a good time in Vegas, right?
True.
I just want to point out that you played more like slot machines than I did.
yeah, you know what, like, that was almost a result of how poorly I did at sports betting. Like basically, like, you know, I started out with, like, the plan of, like, okay, like, you know, I'll throw down, like, you know, 20 or 40 each day on sports bets, and I'll just live off of that. Like, yeah, I'll go where that money takes me. And, like, every single, like, parlay sports bet I made, like, and I don't know if this is a good or a bad thing, but, like, I basically lost the first bet of each one. So it's like, yeah. So I didn't even get, like, the sort of, like, thrill of being, like, okay, like, one down, two to go, or something like that. It was basically like, oh, zero down each time. So, like,
well, not to, like, sound like a blowhard because I won money in Vegas, but if for any of our listeners, if you're going to Las Vegas to make, like, sports bets,
right?
Here's what you do. You take your most confident bet and you put a lot of money on that. And then you take your second two most confident bets and you parlay it. Two team parlay, and then you get better odds.
Right.
But if you don't do any more than a two team parlay.
Right.
My friend Lisa told me, and she was totally right. I used to be like the king, not the king, but I used to be addicted to 14 parlays.
Yeah, like which I still sort of am. Like,
you put like $20 down, you can win like $300, right?
Right.
But like 14 parlays are the devil.
They are.
You will win three games and then you will tear your fingernails out about the fourth game and then lose it all.
Or if you're like me, you'll lose your first game and just be like, well, that was fun. Like, yeah, it's like, now, like, you know, now I've got nothing. But
on the way back, like, you flew back, but I drove back through.
Because I'm a big shot.
Because you're a big shot. I drove up to Carson City.
Mm-hmm.
And I stayed at like right behind the Carson City Nugget, and I was like, you know what? Like, I didn't play any like video slot machines, so I sat down and I found a slot machine that I liked, and it was called "She's a Rich Girl," and of course I picked it because I love Hall & Oates.
Right.
I didn't hear Hall & Oates once the entire time I was there, but. Like, I kind of tell people, like, I'm not that competitive a person, but, like, really, like, it is inside me, like, and it comes out, because, like, I started playing this, like, you know, video slot machine, and suddenly I started to think that I was getting, like, cheated by the slot machine.
By this very rich girl that you would...
yeah, exactly.
Come on, rich girl, you got money.
And I got, like, I felt like it happened once, it happened twice, and the third time I got really furious, and I was just like, wait a minute, you know what? This is where, like, I stopped playing the nickel slot machine because, like, in my mind, I'm like, you can, like, fast forward, like, a few hours later, and I'm getting escorted out by, like, a security guard and, like, a representative of the casino, and I'm screaming something like, you tell me how, like, two diamonds and three necklaces is not a rich girl double bonus. Explain that to me. Can you?
Come on. She's getting by on the old man's money.
I will leave. I will totally leave if anyone can explain that to me. You can't, because you never could in the first place. So, I was like, probably best if I just, like, go home, go back to the hotel, and go to bed.
Probably a lot of people in Carson City jail, like, swapping the same story. Like, you don't understand, like, it said kitty glitter, and, like, kitties are great.
How did I not get the kitty glitter bonus?
Fantastic. But no, yeah, like this place has performed quite well, and like, yeah, we could certainly like do like a bullshit pint or something like that. But like, you know what, eyeballing it, like it's not a bullshit pint. No way it ever would be.
We don't have to worry about it.
We've established that there are most likely dogs like allowed in here. Like, it's certainly the very back. I think that's that's where, like, you know, sort of the rules of the restaurant, like, sort of cease to exist, or like back in the very back where you, like, smoking is totally allowed. And
are you saying, like, the rules of the restaurant, like, in the back, that's where, like, all the physics breaks down?
It's like offshore betting or something.
It's like the event horizon of a black hole.
Exactly. Like, once you get out there, like, it's the
did we mention they're smoking allowed here?
Well, yeah, in the very back.
Like, in the very back. Like, yeah.
Yeah. Which, now they're trying to, like, sway us the other way with, like,
they're playing this is a
Joe Cocker, right? Like,
or is it
Joe
Ray
Cocker
Charles?
Just do this? Oh, maybe you're right. Okay, this isn't quite as bad.
Yeah. Well, it doesn't matter. But you know what? It's weird because, like, this is a great place. If you're coming to the Parkside for a band,
yeah,
I feel like, you know, it's a fantastic place to go to. And, like, you're just like, oh, yeah, I have everything I need here. I can just, like, drink and eat and watch a band. It's great. But I also feel like if you're, like, somebody who... Because it's out of the way, a lot of people, they don't get a whole lot of foot traffic here, but they should. Like, if you were, like, somebody from out of town, and you're like, look, I can either go to, like, the Lower Haight and hit, like, four bars, or I can just go to one good bar.
Yeah.
Like, the Parkside would be the one good bar you would go to. Like, go out of your way. I mean, there's another bar in the neighborhood called Connecticut Yankee.
Yeah.
So, I guess you could bar hop over to there. But, like, this is such a great bar that If you had one night to only do one bar, this would be the one.
Totally. I couldn't agree more. I think just everything from like the aesthetic of it to like, I mean, like you sort of walk in, like, you know, experience it one way, and then when you walk out, like it's almost like a different place. Like, you know, like there's like a lot going on. No pool table, no dart table, no pinball.
Not necessary. But you can go across the street to Jackson Park and play drunken wiffle ball if you brought those.
There we go.
Which is what I'm going to do right after we get out of there.
If you planned ahead and brought a bat and ball, then the world is yours. The world is your oyster.
All right, let's take a break. We can digest this food a little bit, and we'll come back.
Sounds good.
This is SF Barcast at the Parkside. She said I'll throw my away. They're just photos after all. I can't make you hang around. I can't wash you off my skin. Outside the frame is what we're leaving out. Won't remember. This is SF Barcast, and we are back.
We're back.
At the Parkside in Potrero Hill.
Extra E turns out to be for excellent food.
Excellent food is right.
And not extra P.
And not so much extra P.
Thank God.
If you need extra P, like, find it on your own.
Hey, I'm sure they'll put it in there for an extra dollar or so.
So what's our final analysis of this bar?
Oh, I couldn't be happier. I think from start to finish, like... From head to toe.
This place is, I mean, we're not here when they're playing music, but like all of the flyers for the bands that are up, it's like, you know, they're local small bands. So, right. Like, you know, you...
Well, and even some like sort of semi-obscure, like, you know, acts that are like from, you know, really out of town. Like, I guess the one tonight is from like Mexico City or something like that.
Really?
So
it's a great venue for young up-and-coming bands.
Exactly.
It's got a great kitchen.
True.
They play great music.
True.
They have a great backyard.
Right.
Every time I say they have a great backyard, I feel like it's some sort of like
sexy
thing.
I like how they shake their backyard.
They have a wonderful bar cat named Powder.
True.
Who regulates this whole place.
He does regulate, indeed.
The bartender was very nice to us.
Yeah, totally.
Like, they were playing
No complaints.
The Hell's Angels movie when we came in with Jack Nicholson.
True.
They have a photo booth.
They have a photo booth.
Am I forgetting anything?
They have concrete floors in back.
Conveniently located on the 22 line.
True.
The Muni 22 line. And very close to the Culinary Academy and the...
close to elementary school children?
Close to the Culinary Academy and also close to UCSF Stem Cell Research Center, which they have they work together in concert
of course
with each other.
Right. So do you have any like rare diseases that you know you need cured?
Rare,
like,
delicious
stop
diseases.
Stop by here first, by all means.
And right across the street from Jackson Park.
Exactly. And like we have, you know, we have other like recurring features and stuff like
okay,
that.
So what
but
do we
like,
got?
Well, no, but like you know, I think that we've covered a lot of them. I mean, like yeah, like it's definitely dog friendly. Like it's definitely food friendly.
It's a legitimate pint.
It is a legitimate pint.
It is not a bullshit pint.
There's no reason to even go into it, as far as I'm concerned.
What about gone but not forgotten? I'm clucking my beard while I say this.
See, I, you know, I'm not familiar enough, I think, with this area overall to like to have like a bar that I remember. I mean, I know there's places that have come and gone. Like, I mean, like recently, the Love Life of Evelyn Lee closed down, which used to be Sadie's Fry and
Elephant. How long was that place open for?
Not very long, I don't think. Like, I think before.
What's the story with that?
Before it was Sadie's Flying Elephant, I think it was some place called like Magnolia or something like that. But yeah, there was there's a whole big story that maybe someday we'll get into if we go to that spot. But I guess like the locals sort of took it back, like from the evil like you know like sort of you know not out of town but like sort of you know big money interests like came in and tried to like turn it into to a new Bourbon and Branch or like you know Dear Mom.
And that was
going to
be.
Like that.
The Love Life of Evelyn Lee.
Yeah, and apparently the locals said nay to and chased it out of town like with pitchforks and everything.
Like, well, I don't know if the what happened to the guy who owned Sadie's Flying Elephant, but he used to be a bartender over at the Delirium when it was called the Albion.
Right, and quite a lookalike, a doppelganger to.
He looked like
President of the United States in
Bill Pullman.
Exactly.
It's so funny because like when we go down to the Albion, like everybody would say like, "Oh, like that guy looks just like Bill Pullman,"
right.
And it was just his bad luck that Independence Day came out, which is like the biggest movie of the year.
Right.
Because like if you said to somebody like nowadays, "Hey, doesn't that dude look like Bill Pullman?" They'd be like, "Who? You mean that guy from Big Love? No." No, not that. That's Bill Paxton.
Oh, the guy that was the guy that was in that Schwarzenegger movie with Jamie Lee Curtis. No, that's still Bill Paxton.
So, yeah, what's the last Bill Pullman movie you've seen?
Oh, jeez. Like, what was the one with oh god.
He was in Sleepless in Seattle.
Was he?
That was like 20 years ago.
Well, he was in that one, like, was it While You Were Sleeping or something like that?
Oh, maybe that's the one I was thinking of.
Oh, maybe you're right.
I thought that Bill Paxton was in that.
Oh, well. Poor Bill Pullman and poor whoever that guy was that owned
poor both those guys.
Exactly. Heart goes out to both of them.
So my
friends of the show.
Friends of the show. My gone but not forgotten is the Super Shuttle lot. That I've already mentioned is gone, and now they're doing stem cell research in front of, on top of.
I think my gone but not forgotten is this macaroni and cheese right here.
The macaroni and cheese here was fantastic. Macaroni and cheese with jalapeno peppers in it.
I think it's like a four cheese macaroni and cheese to begin with roasted garlic, and then you went the extra step and said, throw some jalapenos on that bitch.
You should have known when I went up there that I would go the extra step. That's just the way I roll.
Said, look, I trust you. I think you make it good, but like, why don't you make it a little better?
Do you have any plugs?
Not really. I mean, just any like obviously like you can hit us up on Twitter and whatnot. SF
also,
SF Barcast, all one word on Twitter.
Also the I was gonna say the opportunity, but also the threat still exists that if you want to write us and pick a bar for us to do, we will do it.
Exactly. Or yeah, leave a review on iTunes, like leave a bar suggested there, we'll do it. Either one of our homes, like tell us where to go.
Just like, show up, yeah, put your feet up like you own the place.
We're empty husks of human beings waiting to be filled with whatever you want.
I guess I have two plugs. One is the open mic over at the Flying Pig on South Van Ness and between 15th and 16th. I was there last night. It is a fantastic and great open mic if anyone's like starting out comedy.
Right.
And my second plug is kind of a two-way plug is I need Syracuse to either win or lose by less than 5.5 points today.
Okay.
And I also need Miami to win by 6 points today.
Wait, they need to win or lose by 5.5? Like,
Well, if Syracuse, since they're the underdogs, if they win, does the they're 5.5 point underdogs.
Oh, I see.
Okay, so if they lose by 4 or 5, I
so
still
you mean
win.
Just win, but the or
if they, I would like them to just win outright.
Yeah,
Syracuse. All
right. But I thought you meant they had to win by 5.5 points. Like, which
no,
would have been,
now,
terrible.
Now Miami, who is a 5.5 point like favorite,
right,
they have to win by 6 points.
Okay.
So those are my two plugs. Can you tell I've just got back from Vegas?
Well, hopefully, hopefully the. Those college teams are listening to this podcast 2 days from now.
Well, like, since the Miami game has already started, maybe they could, like, you know, download it at halftime.
Exactly. we'll go bring it to them or, like, mail it off or something.
So cool. Yeah, so I guess we should finish up at the park side. I like it. You like it.
We like it.
Do you think Drew Harmon likes it?
That's a good question. I bet, and I don't know if Joe Gorman would like it. I'm not sure if if Nicole Kalasich would like it.
I think Nicole would like it.
Sure, she would. She likes a lot of things.
She likes a lot of things.
Except for Argentinians, as it turns out.
And Popes.
Right. Popes. Not a big fan.
All right, so this is SF Barcast, and we are signing off from the Parkside. I am Jeff Cleary.
I am Andrew Lauder.
And we will see you next time.
Goodbye.